If you've ever been to Dublin, you may have walked past the city's general post office on O'Connell Street, and you may have noticed that the building's stone facade is riddled with what looks like bullet holes. Some locals will swear black and blue that these bullet holes are the remnants of the city's violent past. Others are dubious of this claim, instead believing that they are the result of drilling to hang banners. If these holes are indeed bullet holes, how did they get there? Keep watching to discover the answer to this question. Welcome to Intrigued Mind, where today we will explore the Irish independence movement. In order to understand the Irish independence movement, we need to take a quick trip back in time. England and Ireland have had a fractious relationship for many centuries. This dates all the way back to the early Middle Ages, when the English crown wrested dominion over Ireland from the local High Kings, the most famous of whom was Brian Boru. It had been his goal to unite all of the High Kings of Ireland under one centralized leader. He was largely successful in this endeavor, and Ireland was self-governing until the Norman conquest. The Norman invasion of Ireland took place 100 years after the invasion of England in 1066. The deposed High King of Leinster, Dermot McMurrough, invited the devil in when he asked the English King Henry II to help him regain his kingship in exchange for land. One of Henry's nobles married McMurrough's daughter, and when the High King died, he left Leinster to his Norman son-in-law. This would set the scene for the next 800 years, and it was pretty much all downhill from there. The English tried to break the Irish spirit through violence and brutality, starvation and assimilation, but they failed. After the Norman invasion, the English, who were garrisoned in the walled city of Dublin, were initially successful in their military and political dominion over Ireland. But ultimately, the rugged terrain, the lack of infrastructure, and the Gaelic spirit won back parcels of land bit by bit over the ensuing centuries. The English tried once again to assert control over the country during the Wars of the Roses during the 15th century, but were unsuccessful. It was King Henry VIII who tried once more to overtake Ireland, bringing his newfound Protestant faith with him. The Gaelic and Norman Irish Catholic population resisted, but in 1541, Henry declared himself the King of Ireland. Now added to the cultural aspect of this situation was a religious aspect, and the discord between Catholics and Protestants would cause Ireland much conflict and heartache in the centuries to come. The Irish Rebellion of 1798 is considered by historians to be the first major uprising against British rule. Spurred on by the revolutionary ideals of the American and French revolutions, the rebellion was organized by the Society of United Irishmen. Even though the rebels had some initial successes and the assistance of the French, the mind of the English prevailed, and in 1801, the Irish Parliament was abolished, further yoking them to Great Britain. However, whilst the Irish may have failed in securing their freedom at this time, the event came to be regarded as a significant development in modern Irish nationalism. It also yielded one of Ireland's greatest national heroes, Wolfe Tone. Wolfe Tone was one of the leaders of this rebellion. Despite confessing to feelings of hatred towards the English that were personal rather than based on principle, outright rebellion was not what Wolfe Tone truly wanted. Rather, he sought to find a peaceful way for Ireland to achieve independence from the English. He was also a firm believer that men of no property were just as able to govern as men of property. Today, his efforts are commemorated in a quay in Dublin bearing his name. In 1845, a type of fungus appeared which caused Irish potato crops to become blighted and inedible. At this time, Ireland was dependent on this one crop for both food and income. Over 1 million people starved to death, with a further 1 million people fleeing the country for America and Australia. These people were mainly from the southwest of the country, where Gaelic language and traditions were strongest. Neither the absentee English landlords nor the British Parliament did anything to help these people, and their cruel ignorance of the plight of their Irish tenants left a deep mark on Irish folk memory and an ongoing hatred of the English. In the 1880s, Irishman Charles Parnell, who was a member of the British Parliament and an Irish nationalist, led the Irish Parliamentary Party, whose aim was to establish Home Rule. Finally, in 1914, the Home Rule Act, which granted Ireland the right to self-rule, was granted. The sticking point in this was that Ireland remained part of Great Britain, and then the outbreak of World War I saw the Home Rule effort stopped dead in its tracks. The First World War gave the Irish the opportunity to yet again reflect on their being a part of Great Britain. By this stage, it had become apparent that the best way forward for Ireland was to become an independent republic. During the week of Easter in 1916, Irish Republicans launched the biggest rebellion against British rule since 1798. The General Post Office in O'Connell Street became their headquarters. One of the leaders was a man named Patrick Pearse. Pearse was a teacher who was opposed to Ireland's school system at the time, which he believed turned Irish children into English adults. He was a strong advocate of the continued use of the Gaelic language in Irish schools to maintain Irish identity. leaders of the rebellion and their supporters positioned themselves at strategic points around the city, publicly proclaimed Irish independence, then began attacking British troops and cutting off British communications and transport. The fighting was fierce, and it lasted for 6 days, but in the end, the British prevailed, and the rebels under Pierce surrendered their headquarters at the General Post Office. After days of shelling caused a fire outbreak, Pierce's document of surrender stated that the rebels would lay down arms to prevent the further slaughter of Dublin citizens. The Easter Rising was the first armed conflict of this revolutionary period. The British, having far greater military might than the Irish, quashed the rebellion. 16 Irish insurgents were executed, but this was not enough to dampen the Irish spirit, and feelings of nationalism grew even more intense after this historic uprising, in which 260 civilians were killed and 82 rebels died. From 1919 to 1921, the Irish Republican Army, better known as the IRA, fought a guerrilla war against British forces. In the previous year, Republican Party Sinn Féin had won by a landslide in the Irish general election. Shortly afterwards, Sinn Féin established a breakaway party named Dáil Éireann and declared Irish independence. After much violence and fighting, with the Republicans not accepting anything other than a complete break from Britain, a ceasefire was called, and the Anglo-Irish Treaty was signed in 1921. Another national hero emerged for the Irish people during this period, Michael Collins, who was the subject of the 1996 film of the same name, starring Irishman Liam Neeson. Collins was one of the signatories of the Irish delegation on the Anglo-Irish Treaty. The south of Ireland became the Republic of Ireland, and it was completely free of British rule. It had taken them 750 long years of struggle to finally rid themselves of their British oppressors. But this still left Northern Ireland, who had opted out of becoming members of the Irish Free State. For 3 decades, there was a deep unrest in Northern Ireland as a result of conflict between nationalists who identified as Irish and Catholic and Unionists who identified as British and Protestant. This conflict, generally called the Troubles, was characterized by guerrilla warfare waged by the Irish Republican Army and retaliation by British forces. Once again, innocent people were the ones caught in the crossfire, with over half of the 3,500 people killed being civilians. The situation was poignantly captured by Irish band U2 in their song Sunday, Bloody Sunday. Lead singer Bono laments, "I can't believe the news today. No, I can't close my eyes and make it go away. Broken bottles under children's feet, bodies strewn across the dead-end street. But I won't heed the battle call. It puts my back up against the wall." This song captured general Irish sentiment that civilians were sick and tired of the fighting and just wanted peace. Eventually, the Good Friday Agreement of 1998 saw an end to the Troubles, with Northern Ireland being declared self-governing, but remaining a part of Great Britain. In 2014, the then British Prime Minister David Cameron and the then Irish Taoiseach Enda Kenny described Anglo-Irish relations at an all-time high. This was an incredible outcome in light of all of the fighting and bloodshed that had taken place since the Norman invasion of Ireland in 1169. The English tried hard to dominate the Gaelic spirit, but they never truly succeeded. The fact that Gaelic is now part of the Irish school curriculum is testimony to this, and is a nod to people like Patrick Pearse. The irrepressible Irish spirit was perhaps most beautifully summed up in an account written by Irish author Richard Head in 1674, where he describes the traditional folk dance of the Irish. "In every field a fiddle, and the lasses footing till they all of a foam." Even as these people worked in the fields to make their English landlords wealthy, they never forgot who they really were. For more videos on the most amazing forgotten parts of our history, be sure to subscribe to the Intrigued Mind channel, like the video, and leave your suggestions in the comments below.